grace and peace, everyone. It is a beautiful joy for me to be here after 8 weeks of being away. But I'm very sad to tell you that this morning I must share very sad news of a heartbreaking death. At 8:40 this morning, our dearly beloved sister, Pat Siebert, wife of Tom, mother of Jill, transitioned into God's holy presence. So let us hold silence together as we pray for the freedom of Pat's soul, finally released from the last year of her so patient suffering. Holy God, as you welcome our sister in Christ, Pat, in all your glory, we ask you to send your Holy Spirit into our hospice room. Lord, suffuse everyone who was caring for Pat, her husband, her daughter, her son-in-law, her grandson, her hospice nurses and aides. Suffuse them all with your power and mercy. Let them feel our prayers reaching out to them with our love.
Am I a God who is nearby, asked the Lord, and not a God who is far off? Who can hide in secret places so that God cannot see them? I have heard what the prophets have said. They prophesied lies in my name, saying, I have dreamed, I have dreamed. Let the prophet who has a dream tell the dream, but let the one who has God's word speak God's word faithfully. Is not my word like fire, says the Lord?
Is not God's word like fire?
Please join me in this morning's first hymn, The Mighty God with Power Speaks, verses 1 through 3.
Fear being honest with you because we know we need to change.
sometimes we Christians forget that we didn't learn about this just in the life of Jesus Christ our Lord, though we certainly see it overflowing in Christ's life. This is an attribute of God that our brothers and sisters of the Hebrew faith have celebrated and acknowledged since time immemorial. And our assurance of pardon today is from Isaiah, the first book of Isaiah, another prophet. And this pardon encourages us to talk it out with God. Part of that relationship is not just God talking to us, but us talking back to God. So hear now this assurance of pardon as spoken by the prophet Isaiah in chapter 1. Come now, let us argue it out together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be like snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. So let us imagine those things that bother us most about ourselves being transformed in God's love. Thanks be to God.
Same names for us, God's people on earth.
that the prophet is talking to. Things must be very, very bad in Israel. And then in today's gospel reading from the Gospel of Luke, Jesus tells him about the difficulties he's having right now, right here in his ministry with his people, maybe 500 years, 700 years, 1,000 years after Isaiah. Jesus says, none of this is easy for Jesus, though we like to think Jesus is above all that. Even Jesus is struggling. For his work brings about division among the very people whom he was sent to save. So listen now to the words of Luke chapter 12, verses 49 to 56. Jesus is speaking. I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. And he said also to the crowds, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, it's going to rain. And so it happens, and please God, let it happen. And when you see a south wind blowing, you say, there will be scorching heat. And lo, that happens too. You can read all these signs, Jesus says. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and sky, but you do not know how to interpret the present time. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So I need to take a step back from these readings. They're pretty much overpowering, but they are in the lectionary for today. And when I had a hard time picking, I decided I'll just go with what the lectionary is going with. And our job is to wrestle with all of Scripture, so I am thankful for these readings today. And I wonder, this is what I came away from, because everybody that is being talked to in the audience thinks that they know what's supposed to be going on. And so they think that they can interpret the signs, and they think that they're doing God's will in Israel. And that has happened to me many times, and I wonder if it's happened to you, that feeling that you've been thinking you had everything figured out, and you were finally, like, launched and going in the right direction, and then you find out, oops, you've been habitually making a mistake. It happened to me just this morning. I thought I had sent Mary the new hymns, and instead, I didn't send her the new hymns that Susan gave us, so if it sounds familiar, we're singing hymns from last week, which are fitting in beautifully. But I thought I had it covered. I thought I had sent Mary the new hymns, and I haven't. Sometimes it seems so natural what we do, you don't even realize you're doing something wrong. And one instance came to me in particular when I reflected on these readings. It happened to me when I first learned how to drive. I was a young adult and I was going to college, and I remember feeling really lucky because for long stretches of time, my beloved aunt, Aunt Deanne, was living in my house. Now the reason she stayed at our house was a really sad one. She had leukemia, and the doctors were having a hard time controlling. But my aunt had no children of her own, and she loved each of us, the four siblings, truly and madly and deeply. And even with cancer, she made everything fun. What an amazing gift.
just from the internet. And on Friday nights, when she was going through her sickness, if she was with us, she liked to treat us to pizza. And one kid would order and another would pick it up, and we were so happy. And for a while, I got to be the one who picked up the pizza. Auntie Anne would give me a $20 bill. She always had them. They were crisp, just like the baby. And when I brought back the change, she'd say, "Oh, go ahead and keep it." Well, that was really nice, and I was really thankful, and it kind of reminded me of a little $25 check she had sent sometime in my college mail. But after a while, I realized I was no longer the designated pizza pickup person. And I looked, and I saw that there were others who were doing this instead of me, and that Auntie was giving them the crisp $20 bill. And it started to strike me as strange, and then one day, the truth of the situation smacked me in my head. I had stopped offering to give Aunt Diane the change. I assumed she wanted to have it, so I just kept it tucked in my dungaree bottom, and I didn't check in with her. I assumed my own advantage, and I felt like a schmuck. I bet the Israelites felt like schmucks too when they read that passage from Isaiah, when Isaiah read it to them, where God talks about his beloved vineyard and the fertile hill and all God did to raise them up and make them a wonderful and powerful nation. And how God had expected the Israelites to yield good grapes that would be holy and satisfying and nourishing and wonderful, and grace all of their communions and dinners. And instead, that darn vineyard was yielding wild grapes, the will of their own. I don't really know what was wrong with wild grapes, I just know that they weren't useful. They couldn't be consumed. They were bitter. Doing what they want to do instead of doing God's will. And I have to guess that they were thinking, or they somehow told themselves, that all along they were doing what God wanted them to do. Maybe they were performing the rites in the temple that they were supposed to be performing. But this prophet has spoken up, and he gives them a mirror to reflect back on themselves, much like the mirror that my aunt gave me. The gentlest kind of mirror, much more gentle than Isaiah gave to the nation of Israel. My aunt communicated to me by just moving on to the next person. And for me, I heard it loud in my own heart, in my soul. I felt it deep. I can still feel that uncomfortable feeling. 40 years later, we know God's love for us is boundless. God always expects justice from us in return. And that means all the things we know and we've studied about. So we have to share what we have. We have to share from our abundance. We have to make sure that everyone receives justice. But no one's listening to God. And so instead of just that gentle, small voice that I heard silently from my aunt, and that the prophet Elijah got to hear when he was standing on the brink, that just as he just barely dared to come out of his cave, the prophet had to hit them over the head. Today there are so many loud voices, and there are seeming prophets who are yelling about what God wants. And I think it's very confusing for me. But I thank God for this church. And I thank God for all the people in this church, because it is in our communion together that we can silence some of those voices, dampen them, and come here and try to listen to what God is really telling us. When I prepare sermons, I'm so grateful I have the process we use together called worship reflection. I hope we do more of it. Worship reflection stops you in your tracks when you're reading and thinking. When you're thinking, I know what this is about. I've heard this before. I know what God is saying to me. Because we never know. God is always new and always new to us. That's what it means to be in relationship. My husband is here today. If I think I know what he's going to say every time, I'm going to lose my relationship with him. The same thing goes for each of us, and the same thing goes for God. When we have a real relationship, the voice is always new. And so worship reflection asks us to read a passage three times. We read it through and we ask questions on the cognitive level. And then the next step is to wonder, where do I find myself in this passage? And finally, how is God speaking through this text to me? This, I believe, is how we are to use the Bible, not as a rule book to demand things of us and for us to demand things of others, but as a way to hone in, just as this beautiful sanctuary allows us this space. The Holy Bible gives us space to be with God. When I read the story of the vineyard, the experience that came up to me was not one of war or destruction or anger or terror, thank God. It was the story of my beloved aunt who died when I was 22, so not long after the story ended. God knows we have enough imagery, and thank God that God brought me a very gentle story, a story of correction, a story that still held a bit of its sting. This is a grace, and it's just what I needed to receive because I'm a parent of three young adults who are all taking major steps in their lives. And I needed this story in order to work with each of them in last week. Because my aunt gave me two things. She gave me a correction just by her actions, but she also suffused me with love. And this is what we always hear from God. God suffuses us with love. That's why we can go to God and say, God, something's not right, and if I've done something wrong, please help me to see it in my life. We are beloved, and that is what encourages us to know that we are forgiven and reminded every time we come to God who we came from and why we are here, because God has guided us through our lives. In order for change to happen for anyone, to feel affirmed and whole. Our children need that, our young adults, and even us too, as we receive gentle correction from one another. Jesus confesses to us today that the world was not always rose-colored for him either. I came to bring fire to the earth, he said, how I wish it were already kindled. He is under stress until his baptism is completed. It isn't easy to be a mom or an adult child or a pastor or a faith leader. And we have to thank Jesus for these words, these hard words to remind us that division and anger and fury that we see all around us are still part of God's mission on earth, Christ's mission. We want peace, but Jesus warns that it will not always be. To move forward with God's vision of our future for ourselves and for our church and for our neighborhood, we have to develop strategies that enable us to take the heat sometimes. And for me, that's what this 8-week pastor's pandemic Sabbath rest did. It gave me time, it allowed me to take time to just soak in God's bountiful and amazing grace. During this time, I had to do some very hard things. Some of them I did with help, and sometimes I was alone. I had to dissolve my mother's household in New Jersey, where she had lived for 85 years. I had to help salvage a critical subset of everything that was meaningful to her in that home, and then help as she got moved to Las Cruces, New Mexico, where my brother and his wife had become her primary caregivers. And God is good because I could never accomplish what I needed to do while also trying to be a good pastor. I think I would have been a terrible pastor during this time. It was a season when I needed to focus all my attention on my own vineyard. I needed to develop self-care that would help me muster the energy I needed to be wise and loving and caring and do what I needed to do. These things remind me of the beautiful basket of yellow flowers I tend outside the parsonage steps when I water them early in the morning. It doesn't matter how scorching heat that wave is from the south. They can withstand it. And I think we all have to take care of our bodies and our souls and listen to them, because that is where God speaks first. He spoke first to Elijah, spoke first to me, spoke to Jesus, speaks to all of us. Yesterday, my brother, who's going through my mom's old folders, texted us a photo of a thank you card from 1962. In that card, my aunt was thanking my parents in her most beautiful companionship, which is as beautiful as her bacon, for the honor of being my sister's godmother. Now I have three kids and six godparents connected to them, and I wrote all of them thank yous, but I've never seen a thank you note from a godparent. Maybe you have. And to me it seems rare and special, and an attitude of gratitude, and I think that ties a lot of today's readings together. This gratitude that we feel, we can't feel it when we're enraged, we can't feel it when the powers are coming down on us. So we have to cultivate a little garden where we can feel God's grace and radiate some of that gratitude. And this makes it even more important that we care for ourselves. Our bodies are the first place where we encounter the Holy Spirit in the presence of God. I was in Spain, and these words of a famous beloved saint of Spain had a big impression on me. Jesus, Holy Spirit speaks to us through our bodies first. And Teresa said, Jesus has no body on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes through which his compassion looks out on the world. Yours are the feet with which he is about to go about doing good. And yours are the hands with which he is to bless us now. So friends, let us listen to God's small voice before God has to crack us over the head with some thunderbolt. Let us rejoice in God's small presence with us in the quiet of our lives, in the quiet of our sanctuary, because Jesus is counting on us all to do a lot of good in his holy name. Friends, this is my reading of the Word of God today. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Holy Spirit, help us to hear your small voice in our lives and the voices of our loved ones and the joys and concerns of our neighbor. Lead us, guide us, make us yours. Amen. So our hymn of response is going to encourage us to sit back and to feel the river of God's grace when peace like a river. Number 451, and we'll do all four verses.
Thank you. with one voice our confession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So friends, this part of our worship service, everything after the sermon, is part of our response to God. And one of the important ways that we respond to God is taking our faith into our life this week, in the week when we're not together. So I think it's appropriate to try making some announcements about the life of faith going forward. Are there any announcements that anybody would like to make? Everybody can see the insert in the bulletin about school supplies. We know that this is a really important thing that we do, that there are a number of families who can't afford to have all their children outfitted. So it's great that we've started to do this, and I encourage everyone to keep doing this. Also, every other year, Consistor gets to select someone to be honored in the biennial lay recognition dinner. And this year, the dinner is going to be on Friday, October 21st at the Imperia in Somerset. So Consistory has selected a person, but we're going to announce that next week when the person can be with us, hopefully. So look out for more information. And also, just as a reminder that the Loft Church is coming in, it's a reminder mostly for me, because this is new for me, that the Loft Church is coming in after us for an 11:15 service, and everyone is invited to join them if you want to turn out their service. Any other announcements that we need to do? Okay. So now I wanted to ask about prayer requests, and I wondered if there were any prayer requests that anybody had that they hadn't given me in advance.
Okay, I think Emily would like me to pray for her friend Heather, whose son had a horrific bike accident, and the road crash went on his neck somehow, and he's going to be okay. She's going to get a picture of my woman's name, follow on her. So prayers for his recovery and friends of God for saving him.
So when I say we pray to the Lord, I invite you to respond, Lord, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, for speaking to us through small voices. And also, though it's harder to hear than the loud voices of prophets whom you raise up all around us, Lord, help us to discern those whom you have truly inspired to reach us and correct us from those who are simply clever at speaking as if they speak on your behalf, when really they speak from someone else's agenda. This is the straw and the wheat in our lives. And for this discernment, we pray for the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for Heather, whose son had a
Lord, for being with this 14-year-old. Thank you for being with him and sending emergency people into his life and into his despair, and for getting him to safety. And thank you for the medical care he is receiving. Thank you, God, and keep them in your Holy Spirit with them for Heather and for her son, that he continue to make an excellent recovery. Lord, we ask you to be with Larry's mother-in-law and with the family of his best friends, Ike's, after his death. Lord, to lose a best friend after 40 years is a great time of mourning. We ask you to look after this family and to be with Ike's family and to be with Larry's brother-in-law as they mourn his passing. We pray especially today, Lord, for the family of our dearly beloved sister in Christ, for Pat Siebert's family. Be with them in their loss and mourning and help us to support them so that through our love story they may feel you draw closer. For these people, Lord, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we are praying for Family Promise of Hunterdon County. Lord, you know that Family Promise is our way of helping the most vulnerable and homeless people in our community. Through us and through amazing social workers, you help these people and us to do your will. You help us care for your people. You help us teach people how to care for themselves in a challenging world. For all this, we pray to you, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for the congregation of Calvary Episcopal Church, who are trying to provide a permanent place where Family Promise families can live while they are in the program awaiting their own homes. Encourage this congregation and help them to address the concerns of their neighbors in love and care. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we ask you to help us as we seek to continue the commitment of our church to Family Promise. Help us connect with people who are worried. Help us discern how we can help further your work in our neighborhood. We pray all this to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Now I ask you to join our prayers together through the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We'll sing our hymn of dedication, God, the Father of your people, number 927, verses 1 and 2. Thank you.
like to come with me. I'm going to go right after worship. I might say hello for a minute, but then I'm going to go to Pat Seabird's hospital room where her family is right now. And I'm happy to go by myself, but if anybody would like to come, your presence would be most welcome. Now receive this blessing from our Lord Jesus Christ. May the God of peace sanctify you entirely. May your spirit and your soul and your body